Welcome to Show and Tell with the Two Mortgage Guys. We come to you live on Facebook, YouTube, LinkedIn, and Twitter every Tuesday at noon. Today, we're going to be discussing home buying spring cleaning. If you're thinking about buying a home this year, we're outlining important things you need to know to give yourself the best shot at buying a home. Stick around.
So, you know, I wonder how many people tuned in thinking we were going to talk about, like, cleaning your gutters and stuff.
There you go. Yeah. Well, you could do that, too. We could have a show on that one as well.
We probably could. We could. There's probably a whole slew of things you should be doing to your home. But before we get into that, let's help out people that are thinking about buying a home this year. Weather's starting to get nicer. We get more and more people calling us, thinking about getting pre-approved. And you know, there's just a ton of things that somebody should be doing maybe even before they call us. So we're going to kind of go through that today, help some people out.
Right. Cause it's the, like you said, it's spring cleaning. It's like, the beginning of the year, everybody makes their New Year's resolutions about what they're wanting to do. And as we well know, being in the business as long as we have, is this time of the year is when people get the itch to say, hey, I want to move out of my apartment and buy a house.
Exactly.
So that's the cleaning part, right? Is figuring out what you got to do to get there.
There's all kinds of factors involved in why it picks up. Money and tax returns are probably a big one, but well, let's kind of go through this. So look, as far as things to think about, employment's one that may not come to mind. A lot of people have opportunities to start new jobs and they don't think about the consequence of that. For example, it's not just job time for the most part. If you're on your job, if you're working, you're probably fine unless you had a big gap in employment, you know, very, very recently, you're probably fine. But if you're thinking about, let's say you're a mechanic and you've been working for the same place for a number of years, and you're thinking about going out on your own, now you're self-employed, well, you might not be eligible to buy a home right away. So if that's something that you could potentially do after you buy your home, you're going to be better off.
Right. So you'll get, that's one. The other thing we see too, that's the, cause sometimes if you do that and you go out on your own, you're looking at it saying like, hey, I'm going to make more money, which you possibly can. But the problem we always run into, like Ryan was talking about, is trying to average out that income to figure out what's a stable and reliable income source for the mortgage. And like, if you're getting paid by the hour, we can figure it out. If you're self-employed, we're going to need a history.
And another one's maybe going to a commissionable income. So maybe you're not going to be self-employed, but you're going to go from a base pay to commissions, you know, and even if you're anticipating making some really good commissions and you think you're going to double your income, you know, most loan programs are going to require that you've got some history under your belt getting paid like that. So we can kind of average it out. So, you know, a couple big things right there that you may want, if you can put it off after you buy a home, it might be better for you. Otherwise, it could take yourself out of the market for as long as 2 years while you're building that history. So something to think right. about.
And we've seen it, you know, time again, or, you know, we've had clients that have come in and sat down and credit's good and everything comes good, except for we run into that employment piece and then it's coming in trying to calculate it out. And, like you said, that's the piece that's hardest to swallow sometimes is sometimes you have to wait another year before you're ready or 2 years.
Yep. Just had this conversation not too long ago with the client. Let's talk about credit. You know, there's a lot of things you can be conscious of and aware of on your credit. You know, scores are a big one. So if you have no idea what your credit scores are, there's resources out there where you can figure it out. You hear people talk about Credit Karma. And I always tell everyone, Credit Karma is great to monitor what's happening on your credit report. It will give you scores, two of the three bureaus. But they use different scoring models than what lenders are going to see. So if you pull your own credit on Credit Karma and you say, oh, I'm a 720, and then you call us and we pull your credit, we're not going to tell you that you're a 720 because you're probably not. You're probably right. Somewhere typically lower, right?
Right.
But just knowing where you stand, you know, I think it's a good place to start. You should definitely check your own credit. Annual credit, is it my annual
creditreport.com? Yeah. So, and that's a good source, annualcreditreport.com, because you can go there once a year and get all three copies of your credit report. And then again, a little bit, sometimes you get all three copies of it. You don't know really how to read it. That's where we come in and try to help you a little bit. But it is overwhelming if you know how to look at it. But at least you can monitor or make sure the balances are correct. There's no medical collections, that type of stuff that's on there by a glance. You should be able to know what you've got on it. So that's a couple of resources we've used for years for clients.
The biggest thing, the biggest advice we can probably give most people as far as a quick way to boost their score. So let's say you did this. Let's say you went to Credit Karma and your scores are lower than you realize. And you're thinking, man, I need to get these up a little bit. Or even if you've got, you know, a 680 score, which is more than high enough to qualify for most loan programs, it could save you some money, get you a better rate if it's even higher. And so one of the easiest things that we can tell people to look at is credit card balances. Right. So let's explain that, Steve, as far as what people should look
at. So we do, you know, we're coming up with a little catchphrase on it. It's like the 30% rule for your credit card balances. So the main thing you always want to look at is just like whatever your credit limit is on your credit cards or your revolving accounts, your balance always needs to be at 30% or less than that, than your available credit. If you keep it at that, the credit bureaus actually think you're utilizing or using your credit properly. So then they reward you. And once you go above that figure, then that's when you're going to see your credit score starting to drop. And it's because you're starting to live on your credit. And once you get to that point, that's where it gets tighter financially. So your score will tighten and get tighter if you keep having a larger balance on it.
And if you look at any of these credit reports that you can get your hands on, if you look close enough on each, what's called a trade line, so basically each account you have, it'll show what your limit is on revolving accounts. So for example, you've got $1,000 availability and you owe $840. You might be thinking you're doing fine because you're staying within your limits, but because you're way over that 30% of your limit, it actually can hurt you. If you're at 100%, or some cases people are slightly over their limit, that's not good. Like that can have a massive impact on your score. And it's a quick and easy fix. I mean, paying that balance down, and the next time that card reports to the credit bureau, you're going to see an increase in your score. So if you know you're going to buy a home in the spring or anytime now, right? And you go look and you go, well, okay, I've got a couple cards here where, you know, $200 here and $400 there are going to make a difference. It could make a massive difference on the type of program eligibility you're going to have when you call us.
Right. It does. It completely with what it's got on it. So that's one of the things to look at. So one piece back on Credit Karma, looking at the differences, like Ryan was talking about, there's this scoring in what's reported on it. So one of the things with Credit Karma, they use Vantage Score. And one of the things with Vantage Score is they'll report balances like within the first 30, 60, 90 days to where a lot of times on the FICO scoring model, they're going to want to wait to see how long you keep that balance low on that credit card or revolving account. So it may take 4 months to 6 months on your mortgage side for that actually to pop up higher, but at least you can track it and know that it's going in the right way.
Yeah. Good point. Collections. People ask all the time, oh, I know I have a collection or two. I'm going to pay that off. People seem to think that paying off a collection is somehow going to probably increase their credit scores. And sadly, it's not always the case. For most people, they have a collection and it's probably been on the report for a minute. And then they suddenly go pay it. And guess what? It now updates as a paid collection. And it looks to be newer, and it kind of starts that negative score impact all over again. So for most people, like this isn't true for everybody, but for most people, for the sake of increasing their scores, paying off collections is usually not the answer.
Exactly. Because it can hurt it more. Most of the time, more times than not, it's going to hurt your credit score than it's going to help your credit score. Like Ryan said, that it's that date of last activity. That's that key piece that people don't know to look at. So for Ryan's example, if date of last activity was 2020, and in 2023, you get your tax check and you pay off that $1,800 medical bill, bang, all of a sudden that date's going to go up to today, and then your score is going to drop because there's a new activity, even though it was paid off.
Yep. Medical collections are by far the biggest. It's not uncommon. It's pretty sad, actually, how many times we see people with medical collections And in the mortgage industry, we don't necessarily, we're not really concerned about medical collections. We don't really care if you've got a bunch of medical collections or not. Obviously, if it has an impact on your score, that's important. But the fact that you've got all these medical collections, it's not something a lender is going to tell you that you have to pay off in order to be eligible. So I wouldn't worry about that.
Right. And then that was also, I think it was July of last year, that new law went into effect to where medical can't be reported to your credit report. I think is within the first 12 months, which is going to be huge, because what we saw a lot, especially in the last, I would say, 5 to 10 years, is it seems like the hospitals and doctor's offices used to contact the person to set up a payment plan. Now they just started throwing it against their credit report. So now with it going back, you'll have a little bit of breathing room to get those corrected.
And if you've ever gone to the hospital, you know how ridiculous it can be as far as billing. You get a bill from the anesthesiologist, from the ER, from the doctor, from, it's crazy. You think you're done, you get another bill 30 days later, and it's so easy to have that stuff get goofed up, not paid on time. I mean, in my opinion, that's a whole other subject, but like, it's pretty bad. So you're not alone. If you've got anything medical on your credit report, you're not alone. Just know that, you know, you don't need to be trying to run out and figure out how to necessarily resolve that for the sake of getting your scores up. So right. Anything else on credit we haven't covered?
No, that's about it. But I was going to say on that, those are the biggest questions Ryan and I always take. It seems to be rolling off of some of that stuff. So throw up real quick on our YouTube channel. We've got our playlist for the credit crash course is what it's called. And there's a video series in there. And most of them are short. Some of them are less than a minute tips. So watch that if you got some questions, but also feel free to reach out to us and call us, because we'll talk to you about it.
Yeah, those videos will help a lot of people out pretty quick and easily. So let's talk about money, right? Money's a big deal. You want to buy a house, you're probably going to need some money. Although there are some no money down programs. If you're a veteran, I mean, VA is amazing. You can borrow 100% of the sales price, but you know, there's still closing costs. And at the end of the day, you're buying a home. You're probably going to need some money anyways for some other things, whether it's optional things like home inspections or just moving in and needing a lawnmower, right?
Right.
So having some money is never going to hurt, even in these programs that don't require it. Let's spend some time going through that. What works and what doesn't work. And I'll lead off with cash.
Okay.
Cash is no good if you're wanting to buy a home. You can buy anything you want in the free world with cash, except a house. And there's just a lot of laws about it. We need to know where the money's coming from. So if you have cash, if it's legitimate cash that you just had buried in the backyard or whatever, go deposit that money in your bank account. But just know that we're going to ask questions about that for about the next 60 days. Okay. So any actual cash you've got, once it's seasoned and in your bank account after a couple months, now we consider it to be yours and we're no longer going to ask about it. If you just go throw it in the bank tomorrow and then give me a bank statement and think you're good, then you're not, because we're going to say, hey, we saw this cash deposit. Where did it come from? And if you can't connect it directly to you, then it probably can't be used.
Right. Yeah. There's the whole piece of, there's a puzzle when you buy a house. Unlike when you're buying a car or getting a credit card, where there's a lot of questions, a lot of pieces of the puzzle have to come together to make it work.
Yeah.
Yeah. So cash doesn't work like that. It's got to be back in there. Same thing. If you think about it, there's you can get gifts from family members. Now we get a lot of times we'll get people to say like, hey, I've got my brother's cousin that will loan me the money, and that's not going to work. But if it's your direct family member, then that could be a gift that's legitimate. But again, there's a paper trail and pieces of the puzzle that we have to add into it. But that helps as well with it. So,
and the best thing I can say on gifts is if you're thinking about buying a home, and let's say your parents, that's probably the most common scenario, mom or dad, they want to help out. They're going to give you some money. That's awesome. Don't take it though. Don't take the money. Let us know early as possible that you intend to receive a gift, and we'll help you figure out the best way to get the money from mom and dad to you. Okay. Good There's point. Easier ways of doing it and harder ways of doing it. So I would say to anybody, if just maybe get a number that you know they're comfortable giving you so that you can provide that to us, and then we'll help you figure out how and when they're going to actually give you that money, whether they're wiring that to closing or cutting you a check.
Right, exactly, because there's different processes that go through, and some of them are a little easier than others to navigate through. We have the answers, but that's what's sort of a little funny in the mortgage industry is you might think that it's common sense, but it's not. So always ask is the best thing to do first.
You're getting choppy on me, so I don't know if it's you or me. So,
well, hopefully it'll keep going with it. So, how about like USDA loans? That's another thing that's available, like you were talking about, VA. So with VA, veterans, they're eligible for it. Also for USDA, that's a program that's eligible for multiple counties throughout the state of Indiana. And with that program, that's actually going to be geared in to help somebody move into a rural area that just has maybe a smaller population. And like I said, they base it off of population. So for example, in Indiana, you can buy a house in Peru, Logansport, Frankfort, some of these larger cities, Rusheville, Greentown, and it's 100% financing, no down payment. So that's a good program to be in too, to help with it. So
I cut out for a second there, but I think you're talking about USDA, right? So
right. Yep. I just basically covered everything USDA with where it needed to be at on it. So
there's another program, Indiana Housing Authority. So there's actually some grant money available. We can help with that. It's not for everybody. You've got to meet some certain requirements, be eligible for it. But you know, if you've got good income, job time, you're pretty much stable. You've got everything lined up except you don't have as much money as you'd like, or you don't have anything at all. That could be another option. That's something that we can figure out if you're eligible for. If you are, it can be enough money that you get to cover down payment and or closing costs. There's some payback periods. It's not like completely free money. There's some stipulations on whether or not you are going to owe it back. But a pretty cool way to potentially get into a house for somebody who's got everything else going on except maybe the money.
Right. And on that, it goes back to that same thing like Ryan was talking about. You can get there's these grants available, but they still want to be able to look at your bank accounts and assets. They want to make sure you're going into this still with a little bit of money in your pocket or reserve. So you've got to save some money with what you've got coming in on it. You know, tax refunds this time of year in the spring is always a good way to get it. Bonuses, if your employer gives you out a bonus, that's legitimate. You can use that for down payment to put onto a house. So there's multiple different options you can look at employer-wise, as well as looking at stuff that you've got with it for tax refunds and that kind of stuff to piece it together. So I think money wise, that covers about most of the stuff we've got on it. So
yeah.
What about like, you know, we get this, somebody's interested in moving in and they're like, hey, my lease is up at the beginning of April and they're calling us in March. That's issues sometimes, right?
Yeah. Check, right? And maybe there's a way you have to check without trying to show your hand that you're moving out in case you don't buy. But, you know, I think it's good and healthy to know what your options are. Can you go month to month on your lease? Are you going to owe so many months if you leave now? You know, just get a grip on what your options are. If you're currently leasing in a rental contract, that's going to be information you need to know to figure out the dollar and cents that are going to take to make this change.
Right. And once we get through that part and you've sort of got that piece of your spring clean figured out. So then at that point on it, you know, we go back through, it was like employment check, credit check, money check, lease check. And then at that point, that's when you're ready to roll, it looks like. Pre-approval. So that'd be the next stage we'd look at doing. So what I recommend, and Ryan always is, as you go through this stuff, we can do a consultation with you. And then as we do that, that's sort of going to go through and let us know some of these answers to these questions that we've went through with you already, that you've already picked up on the employment and the credit and the income side of it. And then once all those pieces work together, We'll get the loan application. When you get the loan application in, then that's when we're going to start working on it to try to do some type of the, official pre-approval loan reviews. And then we go into a referral partner, Ryan, for after we get them all pre-approved and they're ready to go. And then we can set you guys up, have you taken care of, and then everything else will be in good shape and ready to go on it. So that really covers everything that we've got on it for, you know, sort of the spring cleaning of what you've got to look at with, again, employment and credit. So review back, look at our playlist for the credit crash course, and then also just feel free to comment or contact us. We'll be glad to set with you, get something worked out, or give you a call, whichever is most convenient for you, to try to answer some of these questions. It only takes a few minutes on the phone, and we've had clients we've talked to for 3 months off and on, and then they finally come in and sit down, and we're ready to go. So if it takes time, we're here to help you. So hopefully you've enjoyed everything you've seen today on it. If there's anything else, please share this, like this, and if you have any questions, let us know what you got. Thanks again. Bye. Hey, stick with us next week. We're going to have with us Tori Kelly from the recorder's office. So this is going to be really interesting. So we'll be able to get some information with her to talk about like quick claim deeds, homes on contracts, what happens if you pass away, estates, that kind of stuff. So make sure you stick around and put that on your calendar.